So hello everyone, today I am going to speak about understanding the common cloud misconfiguration using the GCP code. Before going to the small introduction about me. I work as a security researcher at the company called V45. My primary area of interest is around like a cloud security, DevSecOps, and like a Kubernetes security. I regularly share my learnings via blogs or at project at my website like joshuadebra.com. So this is my Twitter handle. Feel free to follow me or reach out to me in order if you want to discuss anything about the security or just have a casual chat. So the audience of the talk is like a red teamers who wants to understand the cloud security, and the blue teamer who wants to know how to secure their environment in the GCP environment, and anyone interested in the cloud security, in especially GCP.
Hey Josh, Joshua, do you mind clicking present at the top right?
What?
On your slide share, do you mind clicking present at your top right?
Yes. Can't you see my screen?
Yeah, we can, but go to your slide, Google Slides.
I'll be just explaining this one. This is good, right?
Yeah, but make sure you go into slide share mode. It's present. Click on present at the top right in Google Slides, okay?
No. I have to switch back between like other things.
Okay. But okay. You click hide on the little notification where it says stop sharing next to it.
Yeah. Hide. Perfect. Yeah, sure. Thank you. So the takeaway of the talk is like, by end of the talk, you will be able to understand the common cloud misconfiguration in the Google Cloud Services. So before going to the actual slides and other things, I just want to explain why I have created this GCP code in the first place. So when I started to learn the GCP security back like years ago, there is no tool in order to for me to learn the GCP security. There are other tools for other cloud products like AWS. In AWS there is like a AWS code, and for the tools like Kubernetes we have like a Kubernetes code, and for Terraform we have like a Terraform code. But there is no tool in order for me to learn the GCP security. The only way in the back days for me to learn is reading the documentation. So being the person who has to read the documentation, I just started to create the tool. So the complete project can be found in this URL, gcpcode.joshuadebra. If you access this URL, you will be able to completely access this project. And also this project is under like a free open source license. Like you could see the codes and be able to make the changes and like add anything, pick anything. And also the most environment that we are creating works under the free tier. So in order to deploy the GCP code, you have to like a working Google account with the billing enabled. If you don't have the Google Cloud account, like you can sign up for the free tier, which you will get like a $300 and like 90 days free tier. So you can make use of this one. So in order to start the project, you have to create a new project. You just have to the Google Cloud console and select the project and create the new project. And you have to enter the valid name of the project. It can be any random name or any project, any name you want to give. And once you have created, you have to go to the API dashboard. If you click the link, it will take you to the API dashboard. You have to click on this enable service. So in this enable service, you want to enable like a three services. One is like a Kubernetes engine, compute engine API, and the second one is the Kubernetes Engine API, and third one is the Cloud SQL Admin API. The reason why we are enabling the API was like whenever we want to access the services programmatically, we have to enable the API. Once you have like enabled the API, you have to click the terminal icon. So once you have clicked the terminal icon, you will get the gcloud shell. So the gcloud shell is like nothing but a VM. So whenever we are creating the project, we will get the gcloud shell. So the gcloud, from the gcloud shell, it has we can interact with the other Google. You can interact with the project and the other services inside the Google. So before like cloning this repo, make sure you are currently under this project, the project that you have created, because like you don't since the application contains the vulnerable codes and some other things, you want to make sure like you are not deploying in the production environment or any other projects. So and also after learning the things, we are going to delete the project. So it is necessary, it is advised to create the new project instead of using the existing project. The first step we are going to go is like cloning the repo. Let's see what the repo actually consists of. So if you could see like there are three folders currently present there. So in the first folder, is called infra. So in the infra, we will have like all the code that is all the application that is deployed in the GCP code. In the second folder is MD docs. So the MD docs is like where the documentation is actually resides. Like if you could see that this MD docs is actually reside inside this folder. And the third folder is like a scenario. So in this folder only, we are creating the script necessary in order to create the scenarios will be in this folder. So once you have cloned the repo, you have to, so it's look like this one. You have to clone this one in the gcloud shell. Currently, I am showing in my local environment. You have to go into the scenarios folder. And here you could see like there are like around six scenarios present there. Let's see scenarios one by one. So we are going to see the first scenario. Okay. So before going to the how attacking the compute engine, I just want to explain the what is compute engine. So the compute engine is the service offered by Google Cloud in order to create and run the VMs. So if you are coming from the AWS background, you could think like it is similar to EC2 instances. So let's see what the script consists of. So every scenario has something like create scenario and delete scenario. Let's see what this consists, what we are doing. In the first step, we are getting the project ID that we have created. So in the previous step, like I have already mentioned, we are creating the project and getting the project ID. In the second step, we are assigning the current cloud shell to the project that we have created. So make sure all the resources that we are creating is deployed in the current project. In the next step, we are creating the compute instance. So we are creating the compute VM called named test, and the size of F1 micro, and in the zone Asia East. So I have chosen this zone like because like it is very nearer to me because I currently living in India. You could also make changes to the zones here, and the base image that I am using is cost table. So the cost table is stands for like container optimized OS. So I have chosen this one because like I am deploying the application using the Docker container. So in the next step, what I am doing is in this step you could see something like metadata from file. So what we are doing is like we are executing the some script two, whenever we are creating the VM or restarting the VM. So I will show the script after explaining all the steps. In the next step, what we are doing is like creating the firewall rules. So whenever we are running the services inside the VM or any compute services inside the GCP, it is by default, it is following the deny principle. What I mean is like, if you are running some Nginx inside the compute engine, it cannot be accessed outside the world. In order to access the service outside the world, you have to make sure to create the firewall rules. So I'm just creating the firewall rules and make sure the 80 port is open. In the last step, we are getting the IP address of the compute VM that we have created and echoing like that this application can be accessed by this IP. So I will just show what the this script consists of. So in this step, I am just running the Docker container. So I am creating one vulnerable application and executing the Docker application. So if you could see, like it is like from this diagram, you could see it's look like this application. You could see like it is like an internal down detector. So you probably heard of down detector. In order to detect like check the status of various web application. And there is also like internal down detector where the company are internally using to detect whether all the services are running correctly and smoothly. Unfortunately, this tool has to be to be accessed only by internal access, but it is exposed to the external world. From this application, you could see there is a URL and the header. If you are familiar with web application security, you may probably find out like what the vulnerability is present in this application. So if you don't know, I will just tell like it is suffering from SSRF. So SSRF stands for server side request forgery. So it's basically nothing but we are tricking the server to make request to like another domain. I will just show one picture and I will explain. So this is how the SSRF will take place. So as the user, you are making one request to the computing on the server. From the server, we are making the request to other server. So the problem with this one is like every compute instance that we are creating will access to the metadata server. So the metadata server is the place where they have like they store about the all the metadata of the instance that we are creating, like when it's created, what are the images that we are using, what's the project that we are using. It may also contains the sensitive information. So this is the place where the metadata is reside inside the Google Cloud. So in order to access the metadata server, there are like two conditions that are to be made. The one first condition is like you have to make the request from the VM. Like you cannot make from the local machine to the metadata server. And the second thing is like you have to pass this header. So in the previous version of the Google Cloud Compute instance, this one is not necessary. But in the recent version, they have made this header as necessary. Once you have like entered these two fields in this one, and when you click check status, you will get like a sensitive information about all the things. I didn't show like output of this one because like it contains the sensitive information. So this is how we'll exploit the compute engine. So once we have executed the script, the folder also contains the delete scenario. So let's see what the delete scenario consists of. So in the delete scenario, we are getting the project ID and configuring in the current shell to access the project. And we are deleting the VM that I created and deleting the firewall rules. I just want to tell like once you have done with the scenario, it is advised to delete the scenario because like chances of like some like malicious people will attack and create damage to your account. The next scenario that we are going to see is like SQL instance, attacking SQL instance. So the SQL instance is the service offered by Google to manage the database. So the main reason people are opting to cloud because like most of the databases are offered by as the service. So you don't need to worry about the underlying infrastructure and all other stuffs like whether the OS is updated, whether the software SQL instance is updated, or like that you have to you don't have to worry. So let's see what the script consists of. In order to start the scenario, you have to go into the scenario 2 folder and see what the create scenario consists of. In the first step, as usual, like we are getting the project ID that we have created and configuring the current shell to use the project ID. So this script expects like we have to pass some parameter after this one. So if you could see, like you have to pass something like a SQL instance name. It could be any random name. So the only condition it will be like it's like six. It has to be minimum like a six letter length in characters. So in this step we are seeing whether we are passing any parameter or not, and if it is not passing, we are just telling hey, like please pass the parameter. And the next step we are creating the SQL instance of the name that you have passed, and we are specifying the database version like MySQL 5.7, and we are using the tier F1 micro because like I have chosen this version because like it is like a smallest tier and work on free tier. And in this one I am specifying the authorized network. So basically the authorized network is something similar to the firewall. By default the SQL database is not accessed by the other services in the other account. In order to access the database, we have to create something like authorized network. But the problem you could see, like I am putting like 0.0.0.0. So what I'm what it exactly do is like it is like putting the database worldwide open. So this is in the last step we are getting the IP of the SQL instance and see whether and we are getting the IP address. So in the next step what I am doing is like I am using the nmap scan. So in the nmap scan we could see the result, like in the port 3306 the MySQL server is running. So I am trying to, in the next step what I am trying to do is like I am trying to access the MySQL server. So in the MySQL server I am passing the user as root and the host as like the IP that I have got it. So in the next step we could see like I have get the shell inside the MySQL. As the malicious actor I could see like it may contain the sensitive information or I can do like malicious thing like deleting the tables or changing the values inside the table. Yeah, so this is how we perform the attack in the SQL instance. What I want to say is like even though it is like a managed service, there are certain security things need to be taken care in order to secure the deployment. So once we have done with the scenario, next we are just dating the scenario. So in the dating scenario we are getting the project ID and configuring the current project ID and getting the shell and deleting the SQL instance. So this is how we'll attack the SQL instance, managed service SQL instance. In the next scenario, what I'm going to do is like I'm going to tell like how we can attack the Kubernetes engine. So before going to the actual scenario, I just want to explain about the Kubernetes in general. I cannot explain like a Kubernetes in like within like 2 or 3 minutes. I'll just try to explain like a short introduction 101 in like a 1 minute. So before going to actually the Kubernetes, we want to understand like what the problem really Kubernetes solve. So let's take the example. You are running the simple web application using the Docker container in the computer instance. Due to some like vulnerability or something, your website got huge traffic, and like people are like 1 lakh, 2 lakh people are start attack like using your website. So due to IAB traffic, you cannot like access the you could see like there is the website got very slow and people cannot start accessing. So what you are trying to do is like you are trying to deploy the instead of one container, you are trying to deploy like a 4 containers. So in order to make sure there is no single point of failure, you are deploying two container in the different VM instances and the different region. So the people can access easily. But the problem with this one is like you have to make sure like all the containers are in sync to each other and all the containers are in very running state. Using doing this task manually is very difficult and not efficient and not feasible in like a in large product. So we have to use something like a orchestrator. This is where like a Kubernetes comes into the picture. So the Kubernetes is the orchestrator you have for running the containers. So in Kubernetes, this is how the Kubernetes architecture look like. It has like a 2 component. One is like a control plane, and the next one is like a worker node. In the control plane, it is like that is on API server. So the API server is through which we can talk to the Kubernetes engine, and the next one is the scheduler. The scheduler will take care of deploying the application, in the it will decide like in which node the application has to be deployed. And the HCD is something like you could think like a brain of the Kubernetes. It is simply a database which has the information about all the Kubernetes deployment. And the third one is this one is like a control manager. So the duty of the control manager is to make sure like all the application are in like a running state. And this one is like a optional one. It is called cloud control manager. So the cloud control manager, what it does is like it acts like a bridge between the cloud and the Kubernetes deployment. It will make sure like all the enough necessary are like created. And the second main thing is like node. So the node is where the actual application is deployed. In node, there are 2 components. The first one is like a Kubernetes proxy. The Kubernetes proxy helps to communicate between all the parts, and the kubelet will talk to API engine. Okay, so this is the basic introduction about the Kubernetes architecture. So let's see what the script consists of. Now to start the scenario, you have to move into the scenario pre folder, and let's see what the create scenario consists of. So first we are getting the project ID as the every scenario and assigning the current cell to the project ID, and next we are creating the clusters. So we are creating the cluster with the base image Ubuntu image, and in the zone Southeast Asia. In order to access the application, we have to have some credentials. So we are getting the credential from this one, and we are creating the firewall rules in order to access the services inside the Kubernetes engine. In the last step, we are using the kubectl tool to deploy the application inside the Kubernetes application. So let's see what the Mongo consists of. So in the first step, we are deploying the Mongo database. So we are deploying the Mongo database using something called deployment. So you could deploy, you could think deployment is like abstraction over the application. I don't want to go depth into this one, explaining this one. We can check out like a Kubernetes official documentation in order, if you want to understand more about like a deployment and what all the things. For now, we could think like deployment as like an application. So by default, whenever we are deploying the application in the Kubernetes, it cannot like talk to each other application. So in order to talk to other applications and outside the world, we are creating something called services. You could think like service as something, the way the application talks to other thing. So there are like three common ways that we can expose the application to the outside world. The first one is like a load balancer, and the second one is the ingress, and third one is the node port. So here we are using the type node port. So the node port is nothing but like we are using the worker node and worker node IP to expose the service that we are deploying. In this scenario, like we are using the 3003 port. So that's why we have created the firewall rules. Once you have deployed the scenario, you have to execute this command. So basically this command will show like what are all the nodes that are created. So when you are hitting this node, you could see like, hey, it's showing like there is MongoDB is running over there. Or you could like, similar to the previous scenario, you could also do like a nmap scan, and you could see like the MongoDB is like running there. Once you have it like that, you could use like a Mongo client instance and try to access this one. So instead of IP, you have to pass the IP address that you have got from this step. From here, you could see like we are getting the shell inside the database. From this one, we can see like all other informations from this database. So this is how we can attacking the GKE. So if you are interested more in the Kubernetes, I highly recommend you to check out the Kubernetes code by Madhukula. So the next scenario that I'm going to explain is like attacking the cloud storage. So the cloud storage is as like other clouds, the common attack surface for the Google cloud environment is the cloud storage. You could see like probably many of you know, like the common attack scenario is like exposing the sensitive information in the bucket, and attacker try to get the access of the bucket and see the sensitive information. Let's see what the scenario consists of. In order to start the scenario, you have to go to the scenario 4 folder and see create bucket. So first what we are doing is like we are getting the project ID, and we are selecting the current cell to the project ID. So next what we are doing is like for this scenario, you have to pass some parameter to the shell, okay, to the script. So we are getting the project ID, and we are creating the one bucket. So in order to create the bucket, I have used the tool called GSUtil. So GSUtil is the tool in order to interact with the Google Cloud bucket. So so the one thing that you want to keep in mind is like whenever we are creating the bucket, the bucket name has to be unique, like across the Google Cloud. For example, let's say there are two companies, company A and company B, and company A is using the bucket called test. The company B cannot use the bucket, even though it has like a even though they are using the different environment, they cannot use the same bucket name. So in the next step, we are creating something called service account. I will explain more about service account in the later scenarios. For now, you could think like a service account is something like other account. To this account, we are assigning the storage admin permission. So the storage admin permission is like the permission where the user can list the bucket, and read the content in the bucket, and delete the content in the bucket, and change the content in the bucket. In the next step, so whenever we are creating the service account, we cannot directly use the service account. In order to use the service account, we are creating the service key JSON, and the next step, we are just copying the service key to the bucket that we have created. In the last step, what we are doing is like we are changing the permission of the bucket to worldwide readable. So what we are doing is like after this one, we are getting the bucket URL. So once you have accessed this bucket URL, you could see like there is something called service. You could see something like this one. So there is something called servicekey.json. So servicekey.json. So when we are using wget to see what are the contents are present inside the service key. So you could see like we are seeing the service account. So this is how we can perform the attack on the attack on the Google Cloud bucket. So please make sure like after doing this one you have to dating the scenario. So in the next scenario, we are going to see how we can do the privilege escalation using the service account. So the one thing that we want to make sure, like before going to the scenario, we have to do this scenario, because like this scenario is based on the previous scenario. So I'll just go into the scenario 5 folder. Let's see what this consists of. So in this scenario, I'm just getting the project ID and assigning the current cell to the project ID, and after that I am just downloading the Docker image and tagging the Docker image to the project ID, so I can push it to the Docker registry and remove the Docker image. So
Joshua, you have 5 minutes.
So you could see like from the previous scenario, we have gotten the service account, right? So from the service account, we have to execute these steps. So basically, in this step, what I am trying to do is like I am trying to switch to that account instead of using my current account. So if you remember, like we have used the storage admin permission. So by default, whenever we are using the Google Container Registry, all the container images that we are using will be using the Google bucket by default. Since we have permission to see the bucket, we are trying to see what are the images that are present there. You could see like there is image called secret. So and the next step, what we are trying to do is like we are trying to download the image that are present, and in the next step, we are getting the shell inside the container, downloaded container. You could see like there is secret file is present. You could see if you perform like cat on the secret folder, you could see like there is super secret is present. So in the real world scenario, you could like see it may contain the sensitive information like AWS keys and other API keys and all. So once we have done with the scenario, you have make sure like you are switching back to the original account and performing the delete account. So the last scenario that we are going to see is like a privilege escalation in the compute engine. I'll quickly explain what the scenario is. I'm just moving to the previous folder. Scenario. So I'm just creating the one simple instance of the Ubuntu OS base and just creating the firewall rules to make sure that it is accessed by the user and just getting the IP address. And the last step, we are getting the creating the simple bucket called credit card. Okay. Once you have done with the creating, we have to make sure like you have to SSH into the instance. I have add a step like how we can SSH. Like if you click this SSH button, you will be getting the shell inside the VM. Next, you have to access. Next, you have to execute the script. So basically, what the script does is like it will download the Python application and start the Python server. Once you have hit the IP address, you will get like a 404 error. But if you try to access this URL instead of IP address, you are passing like something. The IP address that you have got from the previous from the script output, you will see like it will show like if you pass the Joshua in the name parameter, it will show allow Joshua. If you try to with a different parameter, for example GCP code, it will show like a GCP code. So if you are familiar with the web application attack surface, you could probably guess like it's suffering from template injection. So the template injection is the security flaw where the template engine was deployed very in flaw way, which leads to the remote code execution. In order to exploit the scenario, I am going to use the tool called TPLMAP. It's similar to SQLMAP. The only disadvantage of the tool is like it's still using, it's deprecated, and the tool using Python 2. So you have to pass this command instead of IP address. You have to pass the IP address that you have got from the script. So you will get the verification confirmation like it is suffering from template injection. In the next step, we are getting the shell inside the container. Now if you perform the gsetl ls, you could see all the buckets present inside the container. The reason why we are seeing is like whenever we are creating the compute engine, it has like a default service account which doesn't follow the least privilege principle. So once you have like done with all the scenario, I highly recommend you to delete the project to make sure like there is no resources end up. So this is how we can contribute to the project. Like you can improve the documentation and add more scenarios to the code and improve the application used in the scenario and spread the word with the community. So these are my handles that you can reach out to me. And I want to thank you to all DEF CON crew for this opportunity and creating the awesome DEF CON Cloud Vigil Village Virtual. And I also want to take special thanks to Magno for helping me with the whole project and the talk.